So I just stole his Commodore, pulled up at this bank on Pacific Highway at Gordon. So I went in there, I said, listen, I'm not here to hurt no one, I'm here to get the money. I'll just get the money and then I'm gonna go. It's not your money, don't worry about it. No one's gonna get hurt, just fucking lay down, do as you're told.
All that talk to my gang pulled up when we pull up and they all dip.
Alright, yo, this is your boy King Dave here and this is the Fallon Show. Hope all is going well. How about you introduce yourself, my brother, and where you're from?
My name is Russell Mansa. I'm originally from a place called Mount Druitt in the western suburbs of Sydney, but I now currently reside up the north coast near Byron Bay, and I run an organisation, well, I founded and run an organisation called The Voice of the Survivor, which helps survivors of institutional abuse, sexual abuse and physical abuse.
Awesome work you're doing, brother. Much love and thank you so much for jumping on. And you're even doing some work with 501 deportees and some abuses they have gone through in Australia there. So this man has an awesome story and a lot to speak on. But I guess to get us started, brother, so Mount Druitt, huh? That's where you started off, is it?
Yeah, well, I'm told, I don't know much about New Zealand, but I'll tell you what I'm told. A lot of my friends that have lived in New Zealand say it's very similar to South Auckland. You know, it's a low socioeconomic area, it's a battler's area. There's a high representation of Indigenous people.
Yep. So like you've said, there's low socioeconomic area, but a lot of success stories coming out of there. Yours is one of them, brother, for sure. There's a couple of rappers that are coming out of Mount Druitt. What was the demographic, brother, growing up in Mount Druitt? What was sort of the ethnic makeup?
Look, there, in the late sort of early 80s, we started to get a lot of Polynesian boys come and live there. But prior to that, it was like just the Aboriginal people, you know, white Anglo-Saxon, you know, some Greeks and Italians, and some, at the time it was classed as Yugoslavia, but Serbians and Croatians. For me, that's what the attraction to crime was from a young age, because, you know, I would see the boys getting out of jail, coming out looking super fit in the sports gear and everything like that. 6 weeks later, driving, would have done a stick up or whatever, robbed the bank or whatever, and you know, driving around in a flash car with the best girls, and you know, so that sort of thing looked romantic to me from an early age. It was a crazy cycle, but you know, it looked good to me and it looked like fun, and you know, and I. You know, because I'm the youngest of six kids, you know. I'm the youngest of six kids, and none of my elder siblings displayed any antisocial behaviour, got in any trouble or anything like that. They were all working. They all, you know, all aspired to have trades and that sort of stuff. You know, my parents are English immigrants. They came out from Liverpool, England in 1965 with four kids, three boys and a girl that were born in Liverpool, England, and me and my brother were born in Liverpool, Australia. So, you know... And that's what it was. But, I can't say that, there wasn't really drugs or alcohol abuse in my family. But you know, and there was, you know, people can say you had good role models and everything like that. But I never used to see, you know, I just never used to see those people getting ahead in life or having much fun, you know. And that's what was attracted to me, you know. And me and all my friends went that way.
Yeah, I can definitely sympathize, brother, in a way, I guess, with my mum. You know, she worked two jobs and, you know, it's the same. I used to look at her, and even though she was a hard worker, I used to look and it just looked like that's not definitely something I don't want to do with the stress. Yeah. And, you know, they don't look happy and things like that. But I guess with the whole bank robber thing and people you're sort of looking up to in the area, the key word would be looked like having fun. I mean, you yourself.
What happened was me, I stole a car, because I could go down to local shops and learn how to steal 10 different types of cars, you know, because everyone knew how to do it in my area. And so one night I went out with a guy into a place called Parramatta, and me and him stole a car, and we got in a little bit of a chase, had a crash, and you know, unfortunately he got pinched and I got away. And then by the time I got home, the coppers had already been to my house. Old mate wasn't too solid. He was a kid, and they copped that old bullshit story off the coppers. He got verbal by the coppers. And, you know, And then so my parents, being law-abiding citizens, thought it was the right thing to do and take me down to the police station, hand me in. Anyway, I go to court, front court, no warnings back them days, you know, you were off the board. They thought, you know, they'd send you off the boys. I mean, in my case, you know, it was crazy, you know, because my dad was this really hardworking guy. And it was the first time I'd ever seen him sort of show any emotion when he took me to court. And I'm pretty sure I seen a tear in his eye when they were sort of taking me away to do this boys' home stuff. And I was sent to Darick Boys Home, which is at a place called South Windsor. When I got there, it was like four dormitories, and there was a lot of really bad stuff going on at Darick. There was there was a lot of sexual abuse. There was a lot of physical abuse. You know, they really knew their presence as soon as you got there. You knew who was the boss. And they made it quite clear, and I was warned. The boys were saying, you know, things happen here that you're going to see, and I just got to warn you about it. And I soon realised what that was. There was a lot of sexual abuse going on, and in dormitories, you could see these officers, screws, or whatever you want to call them, coming and grabbing kids out of beds and taking them into ablutions blocks, which was the toilets and showers and everything like that, and some really horrible stuff happened at a Barry Boys Home, and I didn't escape that, you know, and that was, that happened to me there, and it left some really bad scars on me. But, you know, a crazy part about that, all the kids knew what was happening there, and none of them really talked about it, and it wasn't until years later that people did start feeling okay to talk about it. You know, as much as I came out scarred, and some people say, oh, well, surely that was enough for you to deter you from crime. Sexual abuse deter people from being criminals, you know what I mean? And if that was the case, that'd be a pedophile's paradise. That's where they just employ them. Say, oh, we'll just give you this job. You abuse kids and you'll cure the crime rate. It doesn't work like that. And what it does, it creates, you know, what I've later learned out to be the underlying issue of a creates trauma. And those boys' homes, all they were trauma farms. All they were doing was just setting, like, you get these kids that come, a lot of kids that when I was there were from, you know, really dysfunctional families or from foster care or, you know, and they'd already suffered so much abuse and that abuse was amplified. So, you know, these people poured on more trauma on these kids that are already traumatized, you know, even, you know, and I can fast forward a bit, you know. So what happens, I got out of Darick, I start really engaging in a lot of drug use and that sort of stuff. And then it wasn't too long later, you know, I stole a Porsche and I got in a car chase. Long story short, got caught and we went before Bajura Children's Court in Glebe, and the judge said, we're going to sentence you to 12 months in prison. Sentence you, and we stipulated it if you served in an adult prison. So what happens is we go to the Central Industrial Prison at Long Bay, which housed some of the most dangerous prisoners in Australia at the time. I think that was 1984. And they put us in a wing. It was called One Wing. It was like a protection wing because we were too young to be in the mainstream. It would have been safer to be in a mainstream prison. And they housed us with, at the time, the most sick degenerates in Australia at the time.
Oh,
the sickest, like a and in my case, one guy was a necrophiliac. A necrophiliac's a person who has sex with dead bodies, you know. So they put us in there. What they, you know, and I think the wing had 100 people in it. Of that 100 people, 80 of them would have been sex offenders of some type, you know. So my first night, they put me in. I later found out they put me in a cell with two other blokes, and I later found out they were both convicted pedophiles. I was abused that first night. It was like, you know, and the crazy part about it was, you know, the screws thought that was funny. They thought, oh, you know, oh yeah, no, we'll put you in here, man. And they're just there, and man, that's just unforgivable. You know what I mean? They're part of it. They're compliant. You know, they're compliant in sexual abuse. You know what I mean? Like child, and in particular, child sexual abuse. And so what happened was, it just went on, like, you know, and I was first introduced to heroin by one of the. One of the perpetrators gave me heroin. He said, mate, just shut your mouth, we'll give you this, and just to keep your mouth shut. And, you know, one thing it did do, the heroin, it numbed me, and it gave me a sense of, you know, I just blanked me out. And and I don't know, just give me not a sense of euphoria, but just the sense of, you know, there was this darkness and the void and the shame and guilt. If I'd have a shot of heroin, I would go away, you know. So I got out. I eventually got transferred back to the boys' home on it's what's called a Section 94A, and I went back to the boys' home, and even there was a lot of abuse happening, but it was sort of kept away from me because they didn't want me sort of talking about the abuse that was happening in prisons, and eventually got out of the boys' home, and I got out with a taste for heroin. And I didn't live at the time. My family had moved from Mount Druitt to Liverpool, and it wasn't too far from Cabramatta. And Cabramatta had a really serious heroin epidemic at the time. And Cabramatta was my regular stomping ground. So I'd be up there using heroin every time. And then I eventually got pinched for breaking in some department stores called Grace Brothers at the time. We're breaking into the big department stores, running in and getting all the VCRs when VCRs were worth like $800 each. And then I got pinched and I went to prison, but this time I went to a mainstream, adult mainstream prison, and it was like totally different than what was happening to that protection wing. Like blokes were from Mount Druitt, older blokes were Mount Druitt. As soon as we got there, they were making sure we had TVs, were looked after. If there was any sort of predators around, I'd fucking warn them and say, mate, you stay away from them. Like, it was very protective. The Mount Druitt elder blokes were really protective of us young blokes. And, you know, I ended up getting, and that was in the days of remission. I ended up getting 11 years for a non-parole period of 4 years. And now I think you had to serve about 2.5 years back then on a 4-year bottom of remission. And, but it was really, I was really fascinated with bank robberies by this stage. And, you know, and I was always, I love hearing the bank robber stories. As you know, in prison, the bank robbers hang with bank robbers, the drug smugglers hang with the drug smugglers, or the bikies hang with the bikies or whatever, you know. And I used to see all the bank robbers sitting around talking, and I used to love their stories, you know, and I'd go and sit with them and listen and soak it all in. I can remember I was down at Goulburn in 1988, and there was a guy there called Ray Johnson. He's passed away now, and he was a beautiful old guy, and he was a bank robber, a dam robber, escapee. And I said to him, you know, I said, all right, mate, so I really like your style. I said, I like how you do things. I'll give him like a reference. And I said, you know, how do you do these bank robberies? And I said, what's your best advice to do them? He said, you just don't do them. He said, because it's a lonely old life of a bank robber. And that was really, he was trying to give me really good advice. And I'll tell you something now, Dave, them words echoed in my head and haunted me for many years to come, you know. I can fast forward from there, you know, I eventually got out. And then I got out in 1989, and September 1990, I was pinched on 3 bank robberies. You know, I done my first one on my own, and then the boys from the Druids sitting at Nate.
Can you go through that one, brother? So first one?
I was at a Commonwealth Bank at Gordon, and I was actually working at the time for my brother, and my brother's an electrician, so I was working as a trade assistant. My brother.
How long had you been out for?
7 months.
Okay.
7 months, but I did try to turn my life around. I tried working and everything like that, and you know, it just wasn't working for me. And you know, and then I was socially using drugs on the weekend, which continued on and on and on. And so my brother gave me a day off on a Monday, and I said, you know, fuck this, I'm robbing a bank. And I just sat at home and I thought, fuck, I'm going to do something. I was always a good car thief, and so I just stole this Commodore. I pulled up at this bank on Pacific Highway at Gordon. So in the North Shore of Sydney, I can talk about it because I got pinched. So I got I went to the second hand shop and I got like a big fucking machete. It was about that big because I couldn't afford a gun. You know, guns were like in $2,000 a pop at the time. And then I just rocked in I was always one of these guys. I was never believed. And a lot of the smart ones said, mate, worst thing you can ever do when you rob a bank is fucking terrorize people because you'll make them panic. And they'll do stupid things. They'll try attacking you. Go in there with a real cool, calm approach. So I went in there. I said, listen, I'm not here to hurt no one. I'm here to get the money. I'll just get the money and then I'm going to go. It's not your money. Don't worry about it. No one's going to get hurt. Just fucking lay down, do as you're told. And You know, and I apologized on the way out. I said, you know, I'm sorry if I've traumatized anyone. I didn't mean to do that. I was just here. I've got a need. So jumped in the car, drove away. And then I only got 17 grand out of that. And then so one of the boys, and that was on a Thursday, and one of the boys had just got a pump action shotgun. And I said, fucking come on, I'll take you with me. I took two of them with me. And the next one we robbed was the Commonwealth Bank at Lane Cove. And that had like, but that was a little bit tricky, that, because the cop station was like 300 meters from it. So we got a stolen car, drove it up the driveway of the fucking cop shop. We fucking jumped out, let the tires down and put a club lock on it so they couldn't fucking get out of the driveway. And then I've just ran with the shotgun up the road into the back door of the bank, and the boys come through the front door. And then, I think we got 90,000 for the three of us out of that. And, it was funny because we jumped in the car and we're driving past. We drove past the cop shop and they're all there trying to move this car to make their way to the bank. And then you know, that sort of money doesn't last, because when you're someone like me that's never really at that stage, you've never had a lot of money. It's like, mate, you know, you just think you've just fucking made your way into the mint. And, you know, you think, oh, mate, that was easy. I'm going to get 30, 50 grand a week, you know? So,
would you be drug affected, brother, would you have a shot beforehand or?
Yeah, no, not the first one, but the second one I did. We all sort of, you know, we all, because them other blokes were all users. And those other blokes were all, you know, survivors of Barrack Boys. And it was funny, the other two I'd done that bank with were people who'd been both blokes from Mount Druitt that have been for Derek Boyzone, and I've met in there. So I don't know. It might have been a bit of a fun finger up to the system as well. And then the next one I'd done was the National Australia Bank at Tarramurra, and it had like a Vietnamese security guard. And there's a bit of a story to this. And so what I've done is I've pulled a gun on him. I've got his gun off him. He had a 32 Browning 7 shot. And this is where we come undone. So the bloke who came with me was meant to go over the counter to get the money, and he never got his balaclava on. He now had a tattoo of a scorpion on the back of his neck, and I'm looking at him in the bank coming over, and I'm thinking, this cunt's got no fucking, this bloke's got no balaclava on, you know, and I'm looking at him, and as we're jogging up the road, because there's a real funny thing in a bank, and it's like time stands still, and it's like when you're going out of that door, it's like you don't know if your head's going to explode like a pumpkin because the coppers are out there waiting for you and they're going to blow your head off. It's, I don't know. That feeling is just, like, it's hard to explain. So you go out and it's like you cringe a little bit. And it's like, and you run out. So you fucking, it was never set. And then you run away, run up the road and jump in the car. And then the exciting part is when you get out and you go home and you empty all the money on the bag and it's over there on the bed and there's three of you, so you're splitting all the money up and counting it and then going off your own way to buy cars or clothes or whatever you're going to do. But what happened with that one was because of that tattoo on the back of his neck, they put him under surveillance. And I just thought, you know, I stayed away from him for a bit and I was thinking, fuck, they must know who it is, you know. But what they did is they just put a surveillance on him, and then they see me turning up in a nice brand new fucking SV5000 Commodore and a motorbike and a ring light. So they took their time and realised, you know, what we're up to. And then one day, you know, I was going out with a girl who was a school teacher who knew nothing about what I was doing, you know. And one day I was at her house and they just fucking turned up and arrested me. And we got to the police station. The other two boys were there, the one who I'd brought the other two boys from Barrack, but they were gangsters, them coppers, man. They scared.
Yeah, well, that's what I was gonna say, because I'm not sure about in Sydney, but I know in Melbourne, like they definitely didn't mess around with bank robbers. Like I heard they'd actually end up trying to knock them. You know what I mean? They were trying they were trying to knock bank robbers. No arrest them, just kill them.
There's a big history of that, you know, that kicking off with that Brian, that Graham Jensen thing, and that where they loaded the car and the gun and that. But up here in New South Wales, they want to rob you. They want the money. They want to get you nice and quick so, you know, they can get you for a bit of money. Because, oh, man, I'll tell you, man, I'd heard stories about them, but they were gangsters. I remember, you know, I went back to my joint and had some beers in my fridge, and they just fucking help themselves to the beers, and all they wanted to me to know where my money was. You know, I think I had in my roof cavity, I'd like 30 grand, you know, and I'm thinking, fuck, I hope they don't find that. And there was a gun up there that was pretty incriminating. I had taken off a security gun. I was thinking, fuck, I hope they don't find that. And I seen old mate on the ladder getting close to it and close to it. And then they found the money and they said, look, cut the bullshit. They said, how much money's there? And they said, there's your bail money. And I said, fucking bail. Yeah, sweet. I thought I was getting out on bail. I said, there's about 30 grand there. So they just counted up the money, split it four ways. And I said, you're right, mate. And they were gangsters, man. They'll try on my shoes, my clothes. They were fucking, yeah. And they'll piling it all up into four different piles of what they were going to take, you know? I was thinking, fuck, what about these cunts? And then, so I got to the police station and they said, you know, we want you to sign yourself up on five. And I said, fuck, I'm not fucking signing myself up on five. They said, sign yourself up on five or we'll charge your girlfriend. And my girlfriend was in her first year of teaching at the time and she knew nothing, you know? And that was that old chestnut. And I said, leave her alone and I'll sign myself up for free, but I'm not implicating anyone else. I'll do my part and I'll just say my part in it, you know. So I'll sign myself up for free. Long story. And then we're in jail and then I come across this guy and I said, you know, fucking, I had this court case at Campsie Police Station and it was a really good go to get away from it because what happened is they pull up in a van and unload you on the street and walk you into the fucking courthouse or the police station. Back there, a lot of that's changed. There's not a courthouse in Sydney now that has that, but back then they did. So I said to this guy, I said, man, let's just get really fit, you know, let's train really hard. And then we did. We're just training every day, doing all this commando training, picking blokes on our backs and running around doing all this crazy fucking shit. Training, and then there was an old SAS bloke there, and he said, I've got an idea for you guys. I said, what's that? Because he sort of knew what we're doing. He said, get a handful of salt and walk up to someone and throw it in someone's eyes and see what they do. So I got this bloke for a handful of salt in his eyes, and first thing he done was cover his eyes up, like, fuck, you know, because it was stinging, you know. So he said, that's what you do when you go to court. And he said, to get that little gap between the coppers, have a fucking pouch of salt down between your balls and your ass. He said, and when you get out, fucking come off the back of the van, throw that in their eyes, you know. And so we got loaded up to go to the van, to the court. And when we got there, I've come off backwards off in the cop was saying spin around. But as soon as I spun around, I went whack through his fucking shoulder in his eyes. And I had a handcuff key, so I had a handcuff off. And I'll tell you, I threw this right hand that I could never repeat ever again in my life. It was the best punch I've ever thrown in my life. And I fucking hit him flush on the chin and just fucking knocked him out stone cold. And I ran over the top of him and then the other boys got in behind me and three of us got away. One got caught. A couple of days later, I went back and robbed the bank again that I'd taken the security guard's gun off. You know, I was on remand for it, the Tarramurra National Australia. And this Vietnamese guy, he looked at me and he goes, oh, fucking not again. And he was like, he just kept on saying, I'm going to lose my fucking job this time. And so we robbed that bank. And then on the way out, I give him his gun back. And it was the 15th of December, 1990, yeah? It was near Christmas time. And I give him his gun back. I said, yeah, Merry Christmas, mate. I hope you don't lose your job, you know? And off we went, run away. And we flew to fucking Perth. And then we just felt over in Perth. We got in a bit of drama. We thought, you know, we were getting noticed. That so we flew to Darwin. And long story short, we ended up robbing a bank up there, the ANZ Bank in Perap in Darwin. And fuck, you know what? I come from Sydney. I thought everything's big. I didn't realise how small that Darwin was, man. Like, fuck, that's just a one-horse country town, like, you know. And we're driving around and there's roadblocks and there's things on the news and on the radio and bulletins and I go, oh, fucking someone must, there must be a mass murder up here, you know? And I just didn't, banks happen a lot every day in Sydney, you know? And then long story short, we ended up getting, oh, I got a funny story. I was Brett got pinched at the airport. I seen him get pinched and I've taken off and I've jumped on a bus about 400 Ks out of Darwin. Anyway, I jumped on that and it stopped a few times overnight and it stopped at this place and I bought fucking the Akubra hat with the fucking corks and that on it and I bought the I Love Australia t-shirt and I bought a pair of secondhand hiking boots with bus driver socks that pulled up the money. So I was trying to look like a tourist. To look like a Swedish tourist. I had a key ring on my side of my pants and And then so we got to Alice Springs in the morning, and I talked to some girl. She was like a backpacker. I said, oh, look, I've got a bit of money. I said, well, I'll take you to a nice hotel and you can fucking, you know, live it up for a couple of days while I'm fucking out relaxing, you know. And she was all for it. And so when I get off the bus, there was like a bunch of blokes standing around. They were just casually dressed. And as soon as I jumped off, they fucking jumped all over me, you know. And I'm fucking, you know, I put on this Swedish accent. I'm saying, what are you doing? What are you doing? And I'm looking at this girl and saying, Helga, Helga, call the embassy. I'm being attacked. I mean, these coppers fucking shit themselves, eh? And they shit themselves. They're thinking, fuck, we could have a diplomatic issue here, you know. I'm saying, call the embassy, call the embassy. And this old copper come up and he had a roll in his mouth. He goes, okay, fucking handsome speeding. He goes, if you haven't got a tattoo on your right shoulder blade, he goes, mate, I'll let you go. And he was like, he was just a cool customer. And anyway, so he lifts up my shirt and there's a tattoo of it. And he goes, all right, Russell, the show's over now. He goes, mate, nice try though, you know, nice try. And anyway, I got moved back up to Darwin and then I fronted court and I got the biggest sentence ever handed out in the Northern Territory for robbery at the time. It was like 9 years with non-parole, 5 years. That's only small in today's terms, but that was a really big sentence at the time. And I got held in Berrimah jail, man. And I'll tell you, man, that joint, oh, man, far out. Like, I because I was an escapee from Sydney, they just had a point to prove to me, the screws, and they just, man, them fucking rednecks, mate, they love to fight, I'll tell you. Fucking, man. Oh. And every day, they had, like, this riot squad, right? And they would come in every day, and they'd send one out. They'd go, here you go, mate, fucking you fight. And they'd go, fair enough, one-on-one. I didn't mind that. They were talking my language, so I'd go out there and fight in. The problem was I was fighting them. Sometimes I'd win, and then they were getting better. They were fucking going away and practicing moves and out to getting better, and they started bashing me, and I was thinking, fuck, this become torturous, you know. Wow. So I used to get the weekends off the fighting, which was really nice of them, so I'll heal up. And then but that was just, I don't know, I look, you know what happened to me up in Darwin, I guess I had a moment, a really couple of big moments of clarity, and I said to myself, because I, man, talk about being treated like an animal, I was being treated fucking, mate, so bad. But I said, you know what, if I give up drugs and everything, like, I'm actually never been in this position, you know. And and I just made it like a pact to myself that I was never going to touch drugs again. And you know, and I went and I did. And I got moved to Alice Springs prison from there. Like, man, fuck, I've never experienced heat. It's like 40, it's like 60 degrees in them fucking cells. It was so hot, man. It was so hot. And there was only two white fellas there, you know, and the other bloke was a rapist, so I didn't talk to him. But man, I really got to experience a real beautiful culture out there with those these people from a place called Yindamu, it's right out on the edge of the Tanami Desert, and the Warpi people, they were beautiful people, and they took me right in like one of their own. What happened was the rapist spilled a bit of water on one of them, like one of the old blokes, and showed him disrespect. And I said, don't worry about it, I'll take care of it, you know. I said, fucking, I told him, go and apologise to that old fella, what you done was wrong. He said, fucking, he made some racial slur. And I said, all right. So I made him an offer he couldn't refuse. I had to punch him up in front of them all, and they loved it. All the old fellas thought that was the ultimate act of respect, you know. So they pulled me in to with them, and I could always sit with them. I didn't understand. I was slowly learning parts of their lingo and everything like that. But I just, you know, when you hear their stories of what they want out of life, they just want to be left alone and fucking live their life their way. They don't want people, like, you know, they've been poisoned. The white man tried to poison them off with alcohol and everything like that. Now they're doing it with sugar. Like, they put canteens out there full of fucking Coca-Cola and they're trying to kill them off of that. And it's just a beautiful culture that white man could learn so much about, you know, and so much from. They're just their ways, man. It's just so simplistic, man. And I often think that I'd just love to go and live that way. And made some really, really good friends. And, my partner and I, talking, because my partner that I'm with now, she's a barrister. She used to be a legal aid lawyer out there, out in Alice Springs, and she knows a lot of the people I knew. You know, our journeys have crossed a lot. So long story short, went to New South Wales. I got an interstate transfer back to New South Wales. I front court. I get 15 years with a non-parole of 8 years, and I do 8 years.
That's for the escape and the...
The escape and five robberies in total, and, you know, so that's including the Darwin one and the one going back. And robbing the National Australia Bank at Tarramurra. So I get 15 years. And I ended up, it was funny, you know, I ended up ended up finishing at 8 years, and I got out, and I went scaffolding with a fucking heap of boys from Tokorua. Man, boys can fucking work, I tell you, man. So I was doing scaffolding with like one of the SAR boys that was going out with my ex-girlfriend's friend. Said, I'll give you a job scaffolding. And, you know, I'd done that for about 18 months with them and that, man. I'll tell you what I got out of that was a really good work ethic, because part of them guys, one of the worst things you can be is a slack worker. You know, they just fucking work hard. They, you know, you're at work, you're here to do a fucking job. Let's get in and get it done. And I got out 8 years clean, 8 years clean and sober. And it was difficult, you know, because what prison doesn't teach you, it doesn't give you living skills, you know.
Yeah.
And it just doesn't give you a fucking living skills. You don't learn about budgeting. You don't fucking, you just, you know. And when we get out of prison after long term, we're so set in our ways. Little idiosyncrasies that I'd picked up in fucking prison, like, you know, about that routine and how rigid we get in prison.
Mm-hmm.
And these people down here don't live like that, so live so rigid, you know. And crowds, I remember going to Boxing Day sale and fucking, I was having panic attacks. I was like, fucking get me out of here. I'd never dealt with the abuse, the underlying issue and the trauma and the abuse. And that, you know, that time, I stayed out of jail for 6 years, the longest I'd ever stayed out of trouble. And, you know, I had a business and I was doing just working and everything like that. But, man, I'll tell you, the nightmares were still happening. And knowing what I know now, I was always going to fuck up again until I dealt with that underlying issue. And so from that point, you know, in 2004, I got pinched again for a couple of robberies in Queensland. And I just got caught up for about, it ended up being 10 years more until 2014. I got caught up, you know, just going in and out of jail, doing 12 months here, 3 years there, maybe 4 years here. And, you know, they went from being really well-organized armed robberies to fucking shit chemists and fucking shit like that and getting 1,500 and shit like that. And I was like, you know, it was just rotten, you know. And I'll be quite honest. And that amplified my embarrassment. And I'd picked up drugs again. I actually started drinking at 12 years clean. And that's what fucked me. And because, you know, if I go... I'm the type of person, I can't have one row of chocolate. I don't know about you, Dave. I can't have one row of chocolate. I eat the whole block, brother.
Same here,
brother. I can't have one tin thing, brother. I'll eat the packet, you know.
Exactly.
I'm never going to be one of these guys that can have one beer.
Yeah.
I'll drink the carton, you know. Yeah. I was never one of these blokes that could have one line of Coke and fucking call it a night, you know.
No. Yeah. No. But, yeah. Hey, brother, so can you touch at all on the... So obviously, you know, you've done a lot of time. So how did you see the New South Wales prison system sort of change, having, you know, like what was Goulburn like and all of those, Long Bay? What was those places like when you first went there to when you left? How much had the prison system sort of changed?
Well, it was massively, you know, and I talk about this a lot, you know. In through the, say, 90s, even 80s and 90s, there was a lot of things that encouraged you to train and do healthy stuff, you know. There was a lot of education available to you. You could go and do courses in universities and everything like that, do university and everything like that. And as they, through the late 90s, they gradually started taking that away and replacing it with factories and prison industrial complex, you know. Their main focus went from putting all the funding into those sorts of things to industries. And it was really a rapid decline. And then, say, around about the mid-90s, it really got violent. Like, I was down at Goulburn when I was there when it all kicked off. It wasn't long after the racial segregation kicked off. And what happened was I was there and there was a guy there, and it was the first of him. He was a bloke. He was about 6'5", 6'6", 120 kilos, and he was a rapist. And the boys come out in the morning. They said, "We're going to knock old mate after lunch." And they like, "I knocked him." And they, you know, and four of them. It was really funny that, like, you know, it was really, because four of them knocked him. There was about 100 blokes in the yard, and no one's seen a thing, you know.
Mm.
I don't know. I say it to this day. I don't even know who their names were. I wouldn't have a fucking clue. I wouldn't have a clue if I ever seen them again. But old mate died, and it's a known fact that he was murdered. And that sort of kicked off the racial, the segregation. It wasn't long after that they started putting the Kuris in one yard, the Lebos in one yard, Polynesians, and Aussies in one yard and Asians and Lebanese in one yard. So they started doing the racial segregation sort of stuff. And I just seen this amplification of violence kicking up. I just, I've got enough insight to sort of look back and go, fucking, you know, look between that. Like, I think in Goulburn in that period of time, I think it was 9 murders in 2 years, you know, in that particular jail. So, yeah, and I was just wondering, when I first went to jail, if you had to use a knife, you were fucking pissed weak, you know, only fucking, you know, and all, you know, and all the good fights, you know, that's what you prided yourself on, you know, you train and reblade and have a knuckle, you know, and then half the time you'd shake hands and that'd be done with it, you know what I mean? But not no more, if I, you know. And my life was a contradiction. In jail, super fit. If someone met me, if you met me in jail, you go, oh, that bloke there's got his shit together. He sells the cleanest fucking in the jail. Mm. He trains 4 hours a day. Fuck, he must go right on the outside. And then you bump me up the cross. Mm. I'm fucking slapped off my head. Yeah. You know? And,
yep. It's, you know, common as well. Like, I've caught up with guys from jail and thinking, you know, these were people that I looked up to sort of in jail, people I really respected. You see them on the outside, man, boned out. You know, hanging on the corner, man, on the nod. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's just like, what the hell happened to this guy?
And it's that contradiction.
It's sad, like, too, you know, though. It's sad, too. Well,
definitely, brother. Definitely really, really, really sad. To move on with my story a bit, what happened was in 2014, I went on this robbery spree. I worked out Suncorp Network Banks here in Australia. You could fucking rob, you still get money out of them. And, you know, it was the case of, you know, the party was over, but I kept on turning up. And there wasn't a lot of money in it. Yeah. There wasn't a lot of money in them, but you could get 4 or 5 grand out of one, you know. So I started, went on a bit of a spree of robbing these ones. And then I nearly got caught on the couple. So I made my way up to the Gold Coast. And I robbed Suncorp Midway on the main street of Coolangatta Beach, the bank there. And anyway, I come out. And as I ran through this alleyway, these guys fitting a Coke machine, and they've just chased me, mate, and tackled me. Mate, they've done my car, mate. Arrest. Yeah, done the super citizen, you know. Yeah. Oh, mate, still my crazy. He's got my legs around the back of my neck, and he's saying, I just saved your life. And I said, yeah, well, can you fucking untangle my legs so I can walk again? But, you know, and what happened was, Dave, I'd had enough, man. I'd had enough. And I thought, you know, I'm going to, from that moment, I said, you know, I'm going to knock myself. When I get to prison, I'm going to knock myself. And I really made a decision that I was happy with. You know, I thought, you know, I can't keep putting my kids through. I'm like 2 kids. And I said, I can't keep doing this to my family. And I got in there, and the objective was to get the coaxial cable, fucking break a hole in the air vent and fucking hang myself. Or someone had been mucking around with the coaxial cable. It wasn't even big enough to wrap around my toe, you know. So it was about so big. It was about 3 inches big. And then I get let out, and I go down there, and this young fella's got all his books out on the table, and, you know, psychology books and everything like that. And I said, man, what are you doing? He said, oh, I'm studying the best psychology. So I took your advice all those years ago, and he said, and done some studying and decided that you were right what you told me. And he said, and he looked at me, he looked me up and down, and he said, you look a mess. He said, maybe you should take some of your own advice, you know. And then and I said, yeah, you're fucking right. You got me. By the time I got back to the unit that afternoon, I'd had a whole new plan. I had a glitter of hope that morally I wouldn't take something off someone I wouldn't like. I've got a bit of advice to give to some younger people that I should take myself. Most of them, I'm not going to get 10 years. I might get a lot less. And if I take the education route, I might do all right. So what happened was, over a period of time, I kept on seeing this thing coming up on ABC. I watched a program called 7:30 Report. I kept on seeing this thing coming up, and it was about the Royal Commission of Institutional Responses to Child Sexual Abuse. And I was seeing what was going on. And I seen that they were a bit fair dinkum, and the people that were pulling into it and questioning that, they were high profile people. And I thought, so I rang my friend. I said, can you get me the address there? I got me an address to that. And I wrote him a letter, and I told him about the abuse that I'd suffered. And a couple of weeks later, I went to court. I got sentenced. I got the 4 years that my mate said I'd get, you know. I had to serve 4 years. And then I got moved to another jail, and I get caught, and I think, fuck, this is these coppers again, you know. And it was the Royal Commission, Institutional Responses to Child Sexual Abuse. They said, we're here to hear your story. We're here to offer you help and assistance, and this is what we can get you, tell your story. And then and it just sort of went from there. So I started getting this ongoing trauma counseling, and I was really getting really good mentally, you know, because I just started realizing how badly this trauma had affected me and directed my life and the decisions I'd made and how I treated people, and more so the opinion I had of myself, you know. And I started to realize, you know, I'm not a bad person, you know. And then I started to like things about myself. And then I finished the tertiary preparation program, and I wanted to study law, and I was looking like I was going to be able to. So this Royal Commission came up, and I told my story to it, you know, and I continued to counsel. Long story short, ended up back in New South Wales. I got interstate transferred back to New South Wales, and a girl contacted me who was a barrister at Legal Aid Brisbane. And she'd heard about my story and what I'd done at the Royal Commission and that sort of thing, and how and other blokes had been telling her, Russell helped us tell our story and that sort of stuff. And so she wanted me to get involved in this justice project for survivors. That girl is now my partner, and she's a criminal barrister in Sydney, Frederick Jordan Chambers in Sydney. She's a criminal barrister, but she also does a lot of this institutional work. You know what? And I say this, a lot of blokes might pull a barrister, and they're normally the big, fat, ugly ones. I actually got a good looking one. You know what I mean? So,
nice, nice.
Yeah, he's actually a good looking one. And the funny thing about her is we're from just two total backgrounds. You know, her mum and dad were doctors, and they've got buildings named after them in Canberra. And fucking, I'm just a scallywag from fucking the outdoor. You know, her brother and sister are both GPs. Her brother's a professor scientist. But, you know, even more so than my own family, they're more supportive of me than my own family are. You know, they're really good people. And I get a bit emotional when I talk about it because I never had that in my life, brother.
Yeah, brother, you deserve it.
I never had people believing in me like they do. But long story short, this is another thing, right? I was about to get released from prison, and I had 2 weeks to go. I was paroled. I didn't want to get released. I wanted to go to a rehab. And I completed that program, and then I ended up in, lived in the community, kicked off the Voice of the Survivor. And that was a learning process, because what fucked me was really badly is I don't need technology, brother. Like, fucking, you send me a link and everything, oh, I'm shitting myself. I normally get my girl to come in and fucking sort this out for me, you know. But, you know, I've been doing this work now for 4 years, it was in September, it's 4 years, you know, and we've got 13,000 clients at the moment.
Oh, right. And that's Australia wide, huh?
Yeah, Australia wide, 13,000. I know in New Zealand they're going to kick off a Royal Commission over there, and I've got every intention of getting over there to do some work with that. Because if
hear.
So I'm sort of getting some work now with consultancy type work of having a bit of a say in what sort of courses that are going on in prisons, and I'm going in to do mentoring work. So I'm going in to tell my story. I'm doing the first one on the 19th of this month at Long Bay. It's a prison that's actually a prison that I actually spent 8 years in, you know. So I'm going back there. A lot of our abuse survivors were 501s, you know. That's fucking wrong. That's wrong. These kids come to Australia, they get abused, they get sexually abused in these homes, they end up on drugs and committing crime. You know, so the cycle of abuse never ends for them. They get taken away from what they've grown up over here, and they get put in a country, and a lot of the times that they don't know, they've left when they're like in, we've got cases where blokes have left it when they're 1 year old, 2 years old, 3 years old, they don't know. And they're sent back to a country, the handcuffs are taken off at the airport and told to go off and do your best. It's like sending a soldier to war with no bullets in his gun.
Yeah.
His chances of survival oblique, you know. This government, this fucking rotten government we got over here, has spent millions of dollars brainwashing these people, trying to believe that, you know, gangs, or whether it be bikies gangs or street gangs running, pose a bigger threat than pedophiles themselves. And that is ridiculous. That if you believe that, you believe in fucking the tooth fairy, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, it's so rotten, and I'm really, really passionate. I'm not pro. You know, people go, oh, you're pro-bike. I'm not pro or anti. I've got, you know, I've got, but what I am, I'm anti-pedophile. You know, these laws that we have in Australia, the biggest benefactor of those sorts of laws, because of the resources involved in chasing bikie gangs and gangs as such, are the pedophiles themselves. I can give you some stats. There's a police squad in Queensland called Maxima. They chase bikers, right? 120 coppers. 120 coppers in that gang. There's a squad that chase pedophiles called Argos, 12. 12 coppers. Wow.
No.
Man, where's their priorities, man? Come on.
No,
the public have got to be asking questions. The public have got to be saying, hey, man, what's, and our kids are more important than, you know, some bikie. And you know what bikie crime is? 95%, the stats on bikie crime, 95% of bikie crime is traffic related.
Yeah.
That's a fact. That's a fact.
Yeah.
And they talk about the ICE epidemic and everything like that. I'll tell you what, I'll tell you where the world majority of the ICE is produced. In fucking labs in China.
Yeah.
Not in some clubhouse in Milperra. But I'll tell you what, I think the bloke that's got 2,000 images on his computer at home, some deviant, mate, he's more dangerous than any bike or gang member is ever going to be.
Yeah.
Ever. That bloke, his next step is raping children. You know, a perpetrator's greatest weapon is his fucking victim silence and shame, you know? And this whole notion of, you know, not telling and, you know, not being a dog, mate,
pedophiles are different. Yeah, no, completely excluded different. From that, brother. Completely.
You know, I say that to blokes all the time. I said, if I can change the tune about that, I said, because you know what? You know our mate's done that. And he goes off and abuses fucking 10 kids. You could have stopped it. You show me a really violent person, right? And I will track down the trauma.
Yeah.
If I can sit in a room for a night, man, my business part gets blown away. Like, I fucking walk through Melbourne. Melbourne to me is, Sydney hires their homeless. They hide them really well. They've got the fucking homeless hostels down the back streets like Woolloomooloo and all that. They hide it really well. In Melbourne, you see that high representation of homeless. You go on Collins Street, Bourke Street, and you see a lot of it around, right? And I'll go for a walk through there. And honestly, I could pick up 10 clients in an hour and a half just by walking up, talking to people, telling my story, showing them my card, what I do, you know, and I can say that. You know, and I often get it. You know, I had blokes ringing from jail who were like fucking big names in jail and fucking the most violent. But and they'll ring me and say, man, look, you know, I just want to talk to you about something. I've never told anyone this. And what a privilege. I've done a lot. I think I've done 2,000 abuse interviews myself. I listen to about 2,000 abuse interviews myself. And what a privilege. These days, because my main focus is on, like, you know, I'm still doing my best for abuse survivors, and I'll represent them everywhere I can and everywhere I can, and in these forums or whatever, you know, like I got talked to Justice Health the other day. They're just fucking shitbags, mate. They think a Panadol will fucking cure a broken leg, you know, and I just give it to them. I just tell them how it is. I said, if you think I'm going to get here and fucking just tell you one of your own, I said, just fucking cut me off now, because I'm about to fucking give it to you as good and proper. And you know, and to their credit, the other day they let it roll, you know, and fucking give me a standing ovation for fucking calling them more shit cunts, which they already know, you know. And I just want to be a big part in the change, brother. I just want to be a big part in the change. I don't think people, you know, fucking, you just, we got this fucking grub over here. He's Peter Dutton, man. Fuck, man.
Yeah, he's a grub, brother.
He's a grub. Yeah, he's just a fucking grub. And he's like, he's a corrupt fucking cop. Like, he was dodgy as fuck as a cop, you know. And the sad part about that, you know, is he could one day be a prime minister and when things won't get better. But this is this thing, you know, the work I do, and hopefully it's just not here in Australia. Hopefully we can get on the international stage and talk about it, because it just, man, let's stop the bullshit, start telling the truth and fucking changing things, you know.
Brother, I'm with you every step in the way, man. I mean, brother, it's been an honor, man, to have you on here to be able to share your story. I mean, at the end of the day, brother, even with what I'm doing, man, the end goal is a safer community at the end of the day, brother. You know what I mean? That's all we're trying to do, man. Show underlying stuff, you know what I mean? Not just all this distractions that the media chuck in the mix and all of that sort of stuff. But look, brother, we're coming to near the end now, brother. So, I mean, to finish off, brother, what's your message, man, to someone... a brother or a sister out there that is, you know, either here in New Zealand or Australia that has been through some form of abuse, especially institutional abuse. What was sort of your message for them, brother?
Tell them they can contact us on, they can contact us on the Voice of the Survivor, on the Voice of the Survivor Instagram. We're on the Voice of the Survivor Facebook, www.thevoiceofthesurvivor.com. We can help you guys. There's no doubt about that. We can definitely help you. We'd love to help you. We would dead set love to. Our organisation is extremely passionate about that because it's triple jeopardy, isn't it? It really is. It's just it's ridiculous what happened, this ridiculous, ridiculous law. And if we can do anything to improve your quality of life, whatever country you may have ended in, because we'll get you across the line. We'll get you something that can create memories for you, that can create a better life from wherever you've landed. That's what we'll do, you know, and we'll do it and we'll do it well. I'll take my hat off you, Dave, man. That must have been so tough what happened to you, brother. Man, your story's inspirational to get over there and man, to kick it off again, brother, and try to be, you know, and being a voice. And you yourself are an educator, you know. You should be proud of the work that you're doing, brother, because together we can, you know, together we can make a change, you know. That's what if we all get together, man, I'm telling you, we're a force, you know.
Yeah. No, exactly, man. So it's been awesome to connect, brother. And I mean, yeah, man, thevoiceofasurvivor.com, you know, go check it out, viewers. If you know anyone, you know, any sort of abuse survivors, you know, get in contact.
Even if it's physical abuse, we can help. We can help. If they suffered, like a lot of people go, oh, I was only punched up, and that, we can still help, you know. It doesn't all just have to be sexual abuse, but we can still help. Man, please do contact us, man.
Yeah, yep. Oh, man, incredible work you do, brother, I swear. And, man, you're an inspiration, brother. You're going to keep me going in all of this as well, man. And, look, brother, it's been an honor having you on, man. Thank you so much for taking some time out of your busy schedule, man, to have a yarn. Wishing you nothing but the best, brother. And look, we're going to talk soon anyway, brother. So, again, much love.
Much love, though.